podcast. I welcome you. I love every chance I get to be with you and every chance I get to walk through this earth that God has gifted us to be together, but also to share his message and make sure that those who have not yet heard of the saving grace found through Jesus Christ might hear it. And it's not always because they grace the doors of this or any other church on a Sunday morning. It might not be because they pick their Bible up for the first time and they read of that story of love and grace. It might be the words that come out of your mouth. It might be the smile on your face when you walk into a room when they are hurting and they need someone. It might be the hug and the embrace that you're able to share. So just remember that these words don't just grace these walls. These stories of love and grace and the power of God the Father aren't just for us. They're for us to share as we go throughout our daily lives. So I hope that as you rise up on your feet this morning, as we start in worship, that there might be a song this morning, there might be a scripture in the message, there might be that little piece that you take away that you say, you know what, I've got somebody I can share this with.
Rejoice in our sufferings. So if that means we rejoice in the scars we have, Because when we go through suffering, it produces endurance and character, and that leads to hope, and hope doesn't disappoint us. So I am going to warn you from up front today, it might be an emotional Sunday. I'm not quite sure why, but I feel like God wants to talk to us today about things deep inside of us. I just want to point out that you hear Corey woohooing a lot in here. And Corey, I want to share that we talked about you at our Bible study Friday night. And his parents shared with us that the woohoos come from a place where there are scars. And you guys have walked through it. And I was telling Joe about it this morning, like as parents, we watch our kids go through things that are hard. I mean, we pray our butts off for our kids. And sometimes the scars are painful, but sometimes we see God glorified through the scars. Mm. So today I'm going to rejoice and be thankful for the scars. And, you know, Friday night, the adults said we need to be more woohooing, because this side is the woohoo section of the church. So I invite everybody to be the woohoo section today. So let's thank God for our scars as we woohoo it. So please pray for me. God, we are so thankful for the joy of the Lord that is our strength. And God, we thank you for the scars that we all have. Some of them are visible and people can see them, and some of us have scars deep inside of us that maybe only you know about. But we're reminded today that our scars help us to see the heart of one who bore all the scars for us. So we thank you, Jesus, that you were willing to climb up on that cross and take all of our sin, all of our struggle, all of our pain, so that we could sit here today and sing and walk in victory and live in freedom and celebrate the scars. We thank you for your heart. God, I ask that you would help us to live out Paul's challenge in Romans 5, to rejoice in our struggles, to rejoice in our suffering. And I pray for endurance and perseverance and character and hope in each one of us. And we pray all of this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Thank you. Which is kind of scary sometimes. And she was saying it, and she goes, I don't have to fear.
And her dad said to her, well, but boys are kind of evil. You should be a little afraid of boys. And you know what she said? But dad, I'm afraid of evil. God's with me. And then her dad said, how do I deal with that one? Write it on the paper, Jim, and put it at the cross. Right? So when we have fear about things, we give it to Jesus, and we don't have to fear because he's with us. Pretty good news, don't you think? So you can keep your fear if you want to hang on to it. You can put it at the cross if you want. And at the end of the church service, I'm going to take all the fears at the cross, and I'm going to take them home, and I'm going to burn them. Throw them in the fire pit out back. I'm not going to read any of them. It's only between you and the Lord. You can take them home and throw it in your wood stove if your parents say that's okay. You always got to ask your parents first. I'm not the authority. Got it? So you can hang on to your fears, you can give them to Jesus, you can make your own cross at home, but I'm going to keep reminding you not to fear because God is with you. Because we're going to keep learning Psalm 23, that we don't have to fear any evil because God's with us and he walks with us through the valley. So, let's go ahead and pray. Jesus, we thank you that we can take our fears and our worries and our concerns and we can bring them to the cross and we can leave them at your feet. We thank you for the promise in Isaiah 41 that you are with us, and because you are with us, we don't have to fear anything. So help us to find out what our fears are and give them to you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. So follow Miss Suzanne. Good job. And then as the kids are leaving, we're going to sing No Longer Slaves. So Wednesday night at our women's Bible study, somebody said, hey, what's that song like? You surround me with a song, you deliver me from my enemies. We're like, it's No Longer Slaves. And we're singing that song today to remind us that when we have fear in life, it's easy for us to think that we are slaves to that fear. But God reminds us, no, we don't have to be afraid because we're children of God. We belong to him and he takes care of us. So please stand and sing with us.
Yeah!
Woo-hoo! And we thank you that because we belong to you, we do not have to be afraid or be slaves to fear. God, we thank you that you part the sea so we can walk right through it, and we drown our fears in your perfect love. God, as we come together in prayer today, we're mindful of many around the globe who are walking through deep, dark, scary valleys right now. God, we pray for those who have been impacted by the earthquakes this week. And we pray for those who are grieving, that you would provide comfort and peace. We pray for healing for those who are being rescued, and we pray for strength for those who are doing the rescuing. God, we are mindful of the way you work through all the things that happen in our lives, even the tough times, and so we pray that you would be at work. God, we thank you for the revivals that you are stirring around the country right now on college campuses. We thank you for how your spirit is working at Asbury, and we ask that you would continue to bring revival in our hearts, in this place, in our families, in our communities, across the globe, so that you would get the glory and people would see who you are and come to know who Jesus is and how powerful he is. So God, we ask that your Holy Spirit would speak today. We ask that you would do what you want to do, that you would transform us, and that you would open up your arms to us so that we would know we can bring anything inside of us to you. And we pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. So I wanted to start asking you the same thing I asked the kids, and I want you to think about, and I asked you to do this last Sunday as well, something that causes you fear. And if you're like, I'm not afraid of anything, well, God bless you. I have about 30 things that cause me fear. I can share one of mine. But I want you to think about something. What makes you fearful? What's something that stresses you out? What's something that is heavy on your heart? What's something that you worry about? Do you have something? Are you thinking of something? I want you to be thinking about that, and at some point, I want you to write it down. And if you need pens and paper, I have pens and paper up here as well. This is something that we did at our women's Bible study a couple Wednesday nights ago, because we've been going through this study by Louis Giglio called Goliath Must Fall. And one of the chapters is about fear and how the giant of fear in our lives must fall. And so at the end of our Bible study, we had to write down on a piece of paper something we fear, but we weren't allowed to use words. So we had to draw a picture. And it wasn't easy because some of us are not exactly artists. But we had to draw pictures of things that caused us fear, and then we had a cross in the middle of the floor, and at one point we had to come forward and lay our fears at the foot of the cross to let go of them. A lot of us in the room are moms, so people drew figures and pictures of their kids. Some of us are fearful of things happening to our kids, or some of us are fearful of things in our lives, maybe people we love not knowing Jesus and not ending up in heaven with us. Some of us are fearful of all kinds of things. I want you to be thinking about that as we talk today, because one of the things we've been learning in Psalm 23 from the Good Shepherd is that even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, even though we have fear and worry and stress in our life, we fear no evil. Dad, that means we don't even fear teenage boys. We fear no evil because God is with us. And because God is with us, he walks with us through the evil. It's easy to say that and hear that on Sunday morning in church because this is a pretty safe place. It's not super evil in here right now. But when you walk into your week, you're going to face all kinds of evil and tough times and scary things. And how do we really handle that? So as I was praying about the sermon, I, ironically enough, felt a really good example come to me on Thursday night in the middle of a stressful ball game. So I'm going to share the example, and if you're not a sports enthusiast, if you don't understand sports, then you can apply this to any other activity or event in your life that causes you stress and fear. So imagine going into something that you're scared of, whether it's you're going into a doctor's appointment, or you're walking into a court situation, or you're walking into a ball game that's stressful. You're walking into it. What if going into it, you already knew what the outcome was going to be? Would that change how you feel walking into the scary situation? I'm going to explain it in terms of basketball, but you think of it in terms of your own life. So Thursday night, we were in the Climber Gym. We were playing another team, and the game got a little stressful, and it was very close, and it was one of those games where you just feel your heart pounding, and like every play is important, and every shot matters, and every point is important, and everybody's in it, and it's just like, oh, it could go either way, it could go either way. If I had known we were going to win the ball game by 1 point at the end, I would have been much calmer throughout that game. I would not have had such high blood pressure. I would not have had the temptation to like yell and scream. I would have just stayed calm, right? If I had known we were going to win. We know as Christians that we're going to win in the end. We know the end of the story. And if we know that, shouldn't that impact the way we live our daily lives? Now, if you go into a ball game this week and you already know ahead of time you're going to lose the game, that impacts you as well, right? Like, are you going to play as hard? Are you going to have as much fun? Like, you already walk in defeated. The sad thing is, most of us walk into our daily lives and we think we've already lost. And the game hasn't even started. And really, we are victorious in the end, so we ought to be walking through the game as if we were victorious. Now, if I know going into a ball game that my team's going to win, I am not going to be near as stressed out. I'm not going to be quite as fearful. I'm going to have confidence. I'm going to know that, you know, if somebody bumps me, if I get a foul, if I get hurt, that's okay because I know that the score is going to be good in the end. We know as Christians, God promises us in Revelation 21, one day there's going to be no more pain, no more sorrow, no more sadness, no more defeat, no more none of the bad stuff. We know that in our heads, but do we know it in our hearts? Why do we allow fear to get inside of us? Or why do we allow sin to tempt us? Or why do we allow all these things to happen? Now, we live in a broken, fallen, sinful world, but the outcome is good. And so I want us to remind each other of that, that we're victorious in the end, so that ought to impact how we live every day. So I want to challenge us to have no more fear. Psalm 23:4 says, "Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me." Is there ever a moment in your life God is not with you? You may not always feel him. You may not always sense him. Maybe we need to start praying more of the Lord, make me aware of your presence. Lord, help me to have eyes to see where you are at work, even in this tough, dark struggle. Because even when we lose the ball game, even when the outcome isn't what we pray for, even if we don't get the news we want, God is still with us. And God can transform the worst darkness into the brightest light. So Joe, go ahead. Last week we were in Psalm 56. Today we're going to be looking at Psalm 57. But before we do, I have another quote from Louis Giglio from his book, "Don't Give the Enemy a Seat at Your Table." Every day we fight a battle against an enemy who wants to wage war in our minds. Perhaps the greatest casualty in this battle is our own peace. We worry, we feel edgy and anxious, we give in to fears or doubts, but we have the power, through Jesus Christ, to defeat the enemy and overcome feelings of fear. In Psalm 23, David wrote that God will not only guide and shepherd us through life, but he will also protect and provide for us along the way. So God guides us, he shepherds us, he provides, and he guides, even in the valleys. So go ahead, Joe. So you can pull out your sermon notes if you have them. You can pull out a Bible on your pew, or if you're at home, you can follow along. We're going to be in Psalm 27, which is a triumphant song of the confidence of David. Before we get into it, I want to share a little bit about the background of this psalm. Last week, we shared in Psalm 56 about how David was kind of in trouble and people were after him. In Psalm 27, David wrote this because he was probably exiled from his home and he was being hunted by King Saul and his men. The psalm reveals that David was in great danger from violent evildoers who were lying about him, wanting to kill him, and they wanted to destroy him. But in spite of the difficult and dangerous situation, David was confident, courageous, and unafraid. So it's easy to be confident and courageous and unafraid when your circumstances are great. But when people are hunting you down, trying to kill you, when people are opposing you, how do you remain confident and unafraid? David knew the Lord and he trusted him. And he knew the Lord would help overcome the fears that can paralyze our lives. So David writes this from a place of knowing what this is. So look at verse 1 of Psalm 27. David says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom shall I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? When evildoers assail me to devour my flesh, my adversaries and foes, they will stumble and fall. Though an army encamp against me, my heart shall not fear. Though war rises up against me, yet I will be confident. One thing I ask of the Lord, that will I seek after, to live in the house of the Lord all the days of my life, to behold the beauty of the Lord and to inquire in his temple. For he will hide me in his shelter in the day of trouble. He will conceal me under the cover of his tent. He will set me high on a rock. So we're going to pause there for just a minute.
Woo!
That's worthy of a woo. Amen, Corey. Woo, woo, and woo again. So David, in verses 1 to 6, and you can see up here it's just got 1 through 5, but we're going to get to verse 6. There was a fear of circumstances. So I talked in the beginning about things you can be afraid of. David had some circumstances that were fearful. He didn't close his eyes to the circumstances around him. Rather, he looked to the Lord and examined his circumstances from heaven's point of view. So that's kind of what I was talking about at the beginning of the sermon. If you can go into a situation and know that the outcome is going to be in your favor, it changes how you go into the situation. If we could look at our situations through the point of view of heaven, that God is working something eternal in us, that he's trying to grow us and teach us and help us to become more like Jesus, that changes everything for us. So I'm going to read this again. This is from Warren Wiersbe. David didn't close his eyes to the circumstances around him, meaning it's okay to say, this is a tough time. This is a scary situation. This causes me stress. This is a rough go right here. You can acknowledge that, but then look to the Lord and examine the circumstance through heaven's point of view. David knows the Lord is everything he needs. He is our light, so we don't have to fear darkness. He is our strength and stronghold, so we don't have to fear weakness. And he is our salvation, so the victory is sure. This is the first time in Scripture that light is used as a metaphor for God. This is in the Old Testament in the Psalms. But you skip ahead to John 1, John 8, 1 John 1, Revelation 21, and all throughout the New Testament, we hear about Jesus being the light that shines in the darkness. So David is saying, you know, people are trying to get me. They're chasing after me. This is tough. This is hard. But the Lord is my light. The Lord is my salvation. I'm looking at this through heaven's point of view. This struggle is temporary. Think about that for just a second. We've talked about that over and over in Psalm 23. The shepherd doesn't say, I walk you into the valley of darkness and I leave you there to rot forever. No, he says, I walk through the valley of the shadow of death. We go through it, we don't stay in it. So whatever circumstance that causes you fear or stress or struggle, it's temporary. In the light of eternity, which is forever, this is just a blip on the radar. So the Lord is my light, my salvation. Whom shall I fear? He's the stronghold of my life. Of whom shall I be afraid? So people come at me, the armies around me, things are causing me stress. So what am I going to do? Remember when we talked about last week, what we focus on grows. So if we focus on our fear, or we focus on the stress, or we focus on the stuff around us, what's going to grow inside of us? But if we focus on Jesus, if we focus on the light, he is what grows. He is what becomes bigger. So one thing I seek after, to dwell in the house of the Lord all my days, because he will conceal me and set me high on a rock. So what if this week you decided the one thing I'm going to seek after is the Lord? The one thing I'm going to do is I'm going to pray. I'm going to worship. I'm going to get my Bible out. I'm going to go to a Bible study. I'm going to seek out people who love Jesus. That's the one thing I'm going to do this week. What if that was the one thing we all did in our marriages, in our schools, in our homes? What if we did that? I guarantee you, fear would fall far away. All right, go ahead, Joe. We'll look at the next part of the psalm. Verse 6, David says, now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me. We've talked often here about how God is at work in the upper story while we are living in the lower story. So God is always working, and if we could only see how he was working. So what if we could have eyes to see, just to get a glimpse of that? Now my head is lifted up above my enemies all around me, and I will offer in his tent sacrifices with shouts of joy. So all the woo-hooing, it's biblical to have shouts of joy.
Yeah.
Woo-hoo! I will sing and make melody to the Lord. Hear, O Lord, when I cry aloud. Be gracious to me and answer me. Verse 8, come, my heart says, seek his face. Your face, Lord, do I seek. Do not hide your face from me. Do not turn your servant away in anger, you who have been my help. Do not cast me off. Do not forsake me, O God of my salvation. Verse 10, if my mother and father forsake me, the Lord will take me up. Verse 11, teach me your way, O Lord, and lead me on a level path because of my enemies. Do not give me up to the will of my adversaries, for false witnesses have risen against me, and they are breathing out violence. I believe that I shall see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living. Wait for the Lord, be strong, and let your heart take courage. Wait for the Lord. Verse 13, do you believe that you will see the goodness of the Lord in the land of the living?
Yes.
Think for a minute, where have you seen the goodness of the Lord at work this week? Maybe it was in one of the sunrises or sunsets this week. The sky has been amazing. I tell you what, I saw the goodness of God in the little kids Friday night that were running circles around our feet at Bible study. Because when you see kids excited to be in church on a Friday night, I'm telling you, that's the goodness of the Lord at work. Maybe you saw the goodness of the Lord this week in somebody giving you a high five or a hug or a smile or somebody sending you a scripture verse. But we need to be paying attention because the goodness of the Lord is all around us. But so often we're so blinded and focused and we're like, ah, my fears, my struggles, this hard stuff, ah! And all the goodness is all around us. What if we could have eyes to see how the goodness is at work all around us? Verse 11, David is praying, teach me your way, O Lord. Lead me on a level path because of my enemies. So in Psalm 23, and we're going to get to this part, it says right after we walk through the valley of the shadow of death that the Lord prepares a table for us in the presence of our enemies. And we ask the question, Lord, why? Why can't you prepare a table for us in the presence of all the people we really like and the people who are like us and the people who make us feel good about ourselves and the people who are safe? Please, Lord Jesus, let me sit at that table. I don't want to be at a table surrounded by my enemies. But the Lord prepares a table for us in the presence of our enemies. Why? We're going to get into that. But it's important to know that sometimes in that, we see the goodness of the Lord in a way we wouldn't otherwise. So we have to have eyes to see that. Verse 8 says to seek his face. Your face, O Lord, do I seek. This is part of what I think is what's happening at Asbury this week. So I've been very curious to kind of follow along what's been happening because I have kids at a college campus. And, you know, of course, as a mom, pray for revival on college campuses. You pray for revival everywhere. To revive something means to bring it back to life, to restore it, to get it excited again. So there were pastors on a blog that I follow talking about, well, what in the world happened to cause this revival? So if you haven't heard about this, at Asbury College in Kentucky, on Wednesday morning, they had a chapel service. And a guy stood up and spoke, and he was preaching on Romans and how to love people. And then kids stayed. And as far as I know, they're still there 90 hours later, and it's packed. Like people are driving in from across the country, and people have been worshiping and singing and praying nonstop for like 90 hours. Like, what in the world? So one pastor said, well, I want to know what that guy preached, because whatever he preached must have really made a difference. And another pastor said, his sermon was just mediocre. It was just a kind of sermon. Well, what was the worship like? Was the worship like really powerful in chapel? Songs were okay, somebody else said. But what was palpable was the presence of God.
Yeah.
And people felt the power of the Holy Spirit. And it wasn't about somebody singing a certain song or somebody praying something or a pastor saying something. It was about God stirring and working and moving. And people were simply seeking his face. And they can't get enough of it. And I know some of you are like, yeah, that's kind of hokey. Like, really, a revival, people in church for 90 hours straight? I mean, people obviously are leaving to eat and go to the bathroom, coming and going and all that. But one person said, I was a skeptic, so So I went just to check it out. Like, I just want to see, is this just a show? And he said, I never felt so peaceful in my whole life. Like, I just felt God's presence. I didn't want to leave. It was just amazing. Like, I don't know if you've had a moment like that where you experience God so strongly. You know, maybe it was at a Footsteps retreat for some of the youth. Maybe it was here in church on a Sunday morning. Maybe you hear a song on the radio and you're like, oh my gosh, I feel God's presence. Maybe you're hunting in the woods. I don't know what it is for you, but you've had that moment where you're like, oh my gosh, I feel God so strongly. What if we sought that out on a regular basis? Do you think God doesn't want to answer that prayer? Like, we pray things for our kids and our families, and Mike and I pray things for you as a church, and it's like, does God want to bless you this week? Sure. Does he want to heal you of this disease? Sure. But does he want you to see his face every time? God's going to always answer that prayer. Like, Lord, I want to seek your face. I want to know you. I want to be close to you. So verse 14 says to wait for the Lord and be strong and let your heart take courage to wait for the Lord. I despise waiting. I am so impatient. I do not like to wait for anything. Does anybody in this room like to wait? Like, are you happy when you pull up to the store and there's a long line and you have to wait to check out? Or are you happy if you pull in behind a line of traffic and you have to wait and wait and wait? Nobody likes to wait. So it was funny, I got a call from Lucas this week, and he's like, Mom, you know how sometimes the Lord just teaches you patience and then he doesn't stop? He's like, I've been struggling with patience in the big things in life. Like, where do I apply for a job? Like, I'm going to graduate soon. Like, he's not very patient with this stuff. But he's student teaching little third, fourth, and fifth graders, 600 of them, in PE class. And he's like, Mom, God is really teaching me patience on an hourly basis. He's like, some of these kids, he's like, you know, one minute I think this is the profession God has called me into, and the next minute I'm like, I better run while I can. Like, those of you who work with young kids, can I get an amen? It's not always easy. But he's like, I'm starting to learn that God's trying to teach me patience. And it's hard. It's hard to wait for the Lord because we want answers now. Lord, I've been praying about this for a long time. Show me what job to take. Tell me who to marry. Tell me where to live. Show me what church to go to. Give me this answer. I don't like to wait. But what if God wants us to wait? What if the whole point is just to seek him and to get to know him? It doesn't matter what the outcome is. Mike and I have been in a situation for a few years that has just caused me internal angst. And I have prayed and prayed, Lord, cause this situation to end. Bring it to closure. Bring it to completion. And it's almost like God has said, just wait on me. Does it matter if it ever ends? If you grow closer to me, isn't that the right outcome of any situation? All right, so go ahead, Joe. So my question for you today, in light of Psalm 23 in the last 3 months, in light of Psalm 56 last week, giving our fears to the Lord and trusting in him, and now in light of Psalm 27, is the Lord your light and salvation? That's the first and most important thing. If you think, I'm not really sure, then you need to get your heart right with God before you walk out of here today. Because part of a revival in anyone's life is making sure my heart is right with God. And if you're thinking, I'm just going to wait till tomorrow, or I'm going to wait till next week. No, like, get right with God today. Have you surrendered your heart and life to Jesus, not just as Savior, but as your Lord? Lord of your thoughts, your time, your money, and your schedule. Because if the good shepherd is indeed your Lord, you have nothing and no one to fear. So back to Psalm 27 and David. So he says that we need to look at our circumstances in light of heaven and think of it that way. So he was fearful of his circumstances, but he was also afraid of failure. David's confidence in the Lord didn't prevent him from being concerned about failing. He knew he was a sinner, but he knew that God cared for him and that even if his parents abandoned him, God would never forsake him. And in verses 11 to 14, in the end of Psalm 27, David was afraid of the future. Anybody in here, you don't have to raise your hand, but are you ever afraid of the future? That's something that is easily causing fear for many people. Did David write these words after he won the battle? No, he wrote these words during the battle. As a wise soldier, he realized that one victory did not guarantee the enemy would stop attacking. Maybe the enemy would retreat, and maybe he would keep attacking. But instead of rushing ahead, David calmly waited on the Lord because he knew his strength was in him. So it's easy to say, Jesus is my Savior. Lord, save me from my sins, save me from my fears. But But the holy longing to say, Jesus is my Lord.
That's right.
Like, you be Lord of my thoughts. You be Lord of my schedule. You be Lord of my time. Like, you want me to go and talk to this person I don't want to talk to? Okay, Lord, if you want me to. Like, you want me to stay for 90 hours after church and not stop worshiping? Okay, Lord, if you want me to. Corey might be here for 90 hours. If the Lord says to you, I want you to write a check and give it to this ministry, I want you to write a check and help those people overseas, Lord, I want you to go on this mission trip, I don't know what he's asking you to do, but I sometimes am like, Lord, you can be my Savior, and like in 2.5 years you can be my Lord, but I'm not quite ready to give you everything yet. But what if we surrendered everything to Jesus today? Go ahead, Joe. So God never promised that we wouldn't battle or face evil. What he promised is that he would walk with us through the evil. He's with us, and that's why we have no fear, because he is greater than the fear. So this week, the challenge is to seek the Lord, to worship him, and to surrender our worry to him. So last week, we had the choice. You can choose worry, or you can choose worship. Now, most of us would say we want to choose worship, but we tend to lean towards worry. So I want to extend the challenge again this week. What if every time worry started knocking on your door this week? Like, oh my gosh, what if this happens? And oh my gosh, what if this happens? Or what if this doesn't happen? What if instead you're like, whoa, I'm going to seek God. I'm going to worship. I'm not going to worry about that. In his book, this Bible study, Goliath Must Fall, I want to share with you what we did 2 weeks ago, and then this is how I'm going to close today. So what we had to do is we had to name the thing that we fear. Write it down, name it out loud, draw a picture of it. So I want you to be thinking right now, what are you anxious about? What are you worried about? What are you afraid of losing? What are you panicked about? And if you think, I can't come up with anything, then if you have nothing, God bless you, then think of somebody in your life you know who's battling fear, and you can intercede for them. So what I want you to do is identify that fear, and then imagine giving it to Jesus. Like, just giving it to him and letting go of it and being free of it. Can you even imagine how wonderful that would feel? Like, to walk in freedom from that? So that's what we're going to do, is we're going to surrender our fears to the cross. So I'm going to have a time of prayer, and the worship team is going to come up and sing the last song, and I'm going to have papers and pens up here, and I'm going to invite you to come get a piece of paper and get a pen, and you can write down whatever you want. If you want to write down a fear or a worry, if you want to write down a prayer, if you're like, I'm not coming up front in front of everybody else, you can go home and do this in the privacy of your own living room. You can do this every day this week. When you start to feel anxious, name it. Say, I'm scared of this. I'm afraid of this. I'm going to write it down, and I'm going to give it to Jesus. Because Psalm 27 says, the Lord is my light and my salvation. Who shall I be afraid of? If the Lord is the strength of my life, of whom shall I be afraid? And then we're reminded back in Psalm 56, we don't have to fear, because we trust God. And the Good Shepherd knows that even if we walk through the valley, we fear no evil because God is with us. So I say we start a revival here today. Wow. I say we bring our fears and let go of them and let God revive us. And you know what? You never know what God wants to do in you. Because if he can take away your fear and you can tell someone about it this week and they can tell somebody, that's how the love of Jesus spreads. So I'm going to close this in prayer. We're going to sing this last song. You're welcome to come forward and come to the cross. You can stay up here and pray. People are here if you want to be prayed for. If you need to leave, you can leave. If you want to write your fear down and take it home and bring it back next Sunday, this is between you and the Lord. So let's go ahead and pray. Jesus, we thank you that you were willing to come into this world and die on the cross and rise from the grave and take all of our fears and sins with you. God, we thank you for how your Holy Spirit works. We thank you for Psalm 23 and the reminder that you are our shepherd. We shall not want. You make us lie down in green pastures. You lead us beside still waters. You restore our soul. God, you lead us in paths of righteousness for your name's sake. And even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, God, we fear no evil because you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our heads with oil and our cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy will follow us all the days of our lives, and we will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. God, I ask that you would work in each of our hearts, those who are here and those who are listening at home. God, I pray that you would show us where we are fearful. Show us what we are worried about, Maybe you want to reveal a sin to us we are battling. Maybe you want to show us something that is just keeping us from living fully into who you have called us to be. God, I pray that we would give those things to you today, that we would lay them at the cross. Lord, set us free from our fear so that we can truly be your children, so that we can see your goodness in the land of the living. Lord, I pray that we would seek your face this week, that we would grow closer to you, that you would bring a revival in each of our hearts. And I pray in Jesus' mighty name. Amen. Amen. Psalm 23, the goodness of God. May goodness and mercy follow you all the days of your life. The cross is open. Let's stand and sing.
Thank you, Jesus!
Every breath.